Chairman John Padgett.
Good evening. I don't know whether we might have gotten a couple more tables in the back there, but thank you for being here with us tonight. This has been an exciting day. We had the first session of the Georgia Republican Party State Convention. We got another great day coming tomorrow. Thank you for being here tonight. This is going to be a special evening. I would like to invite Michael McNeely, our first vice chair of the Georgia Republican Party, to come up and offer our invocation, please. Thank you.
Let's everyone bow our heads, please. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to come together with men and women of light hearts and light minds. We thank you in advance for all that you will do, and we thank you for what you've already done. We understand, Father God, that everything is either God sent or God used, and we pray that we will make the best of every circumstance and let the talents that you place within us shine forth in this earth and make an impact in our local communities, our state, and our world. We thank you for all that you've done. We thank you for each person here that is sacrificing their time, their talent, and their treasury to make this state and our country and our world a better place. We give you thanks in advance for what will be, and we thank you and we pray that you would continue to make us blessings and bless us food and order our every step and word. And while our friend Melvin Everson says, while respecting other faiths, I choose to end this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to ask that each and every one of you remember when you're speaking to the good Lord here shortly, to remember our police officers and our firemen around this country. I particularly don't like that. I value them. Without them, without the rule of law, without the people that represent our police and our firemen, this country is in a real mess. So if you can do that, I'd appreciate it. And with that, would you join me in the pledge, please?
Everybody stand.
Seats and enjoy this meal. We'll be back with you in 5 or 10 minutes. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, can I have your attention, please? Thank you.
That's your headphone jack. We just looked at it.
It is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce to you our junior and newest senator, Senator David Perdue.
Thank you. Oh, I got a treat for you tonight. Y'all thought you had fun today. Wait until the next 30 minutes. Hey, I have the unbelievable privilege of being asked to introduce our keynote speaker tonight. And this is a man that's not unfamiliar with Georgia. He was here twice this past year helping me in my race. And I have to tell you, he called me during the race. I went to Washington, and he was so gracious. And I don't know what it was, but we were supposed to have a 15-minute meeting. It ended up being more like 45 minutes. And we talked about common values, family, country, Constitution, why he's doing what he's doing, and what he was driven for. This is a man that stands for principle. This is a man that's right now fighting for our Constitution every day. This is a man I get to work beside on the Judiciary Committee, and I can tell you that I've seen him stand up to leadership. He stands for the principles that you and I stand for, the values of Georgia. I'm so proud to be associated with this man in the United States Senate. He's my friend, my mentor. It's my distinct honor to introduce Senator Ted Cruz, Republican candidate.
representing David Perdue and Ellijay. He's a man who understands the challenges we're facing in this country, bankrupting this country. We're well past time for the typical Washington comment. We're past the time for games. We need men and women, we need leaders to roll up our sleeves and fix the problem. Now, David and I both spent all week in Washington, D.C. So it is great to be back in America. Now, y'all heard earlier today from a couple of good friends of mine who are running for president. Do we not have an amazing field running for president? Now, by the end of it, it may be a phone book to tell us all apart. But what a testament to the new generation of leaders who are stepping forward, to the governors, to the senators, to the passionate fighters for freedom, the energy that people want to change the past. You know, on the Democratic side of the aisle, I'm pretty sure their debate's likely to be Hillary Clinton and the clerk from Chipotle. Well, actually, that's not fair. A couple of weeks ago, our colleague Bernie Sanders entered the Democratic Party. Which is really quite a testament, because right now the Democratic field for president includes a wild-eyed socialist with dangerous views on foreign policy and Bernie Sanders. You know, Heidi and I are blessed to have two little girls, Caroline and Catherine. Caroline is 7, Catherine is 4. You know, I think back a couple of years ago when the girls were a little bit smaller. They were up in D.C. one weekend. The fall weekend, Sunday afternoon, we decided to drive the girls down to Mount Vernon to show them George Washington home. So we're driving down the George Washington Parkway. Now our girls, you know, when God creates children, he makes every one of them different. Tom, you know this. Every child made in God's image, but sometimes he is fun. Our baby, Catherine, is the sweetest little girl you could ever see. She'll crawl up in your lap and she will hug on you. Caroline, on the other hand, is a rascal. It's the way she's been from the day she was born. So we're driving down to GW Parkway. Catherine's sitting in her car seat quietly. Caroline is in her car seat behind me, kicking the back of my seat to drive. The two of them start to have a conversation. And Heidi and I just shut our mouths. We decided to listen to our girl. And Caroline asked her little sister, she says, "Catherine, what do you want to do when you grow up?" And Catherine says, "I want to work in the U.S. I want to work with Dad." And Caroline says, "Oh, that's boring." She says, "We're going to be rock stars." And then she tosses in the zinger. She says, "Besides, Daddy will be dead by then." With Republican leadership. But let me tell you something. The reason all of us are here, the reason every man and woman came out here tonight, is we love our kids. We love our grandparents. And this country that we love, this country, you know, we're not an attempt. pivotal time in politics. The stakes have never been higher. I don't think we've reached the point of no return yet, but we are close. And if we have another 4 or 8 more years going down this same path, I believe we will do irreparable damage to the greatest country. You know, today, for the first time in history, a majority of Americans think that our kids will have a worse life than we do. 65%. Now, Jody, that has never been the case the entire history of our country until this moment right now. And in my view, the central issue in this next election is how do we reignite the promise. How do we get back to the fundamental idea from the founding of this nation that our kids would have a better life than we did, and their kids would have a better life? That's what the stakes are. So let me tell you how we do that. It's three simple things. Number one, we bring back jobs and growth and opportunity. My number one priority in the United States Senate has been economic growth. Because growth is foundational to everything else, whether it's unemployment, or the debt, or the deficit, or rebuilding our military, or saving and strengthening Social Security and Medicare. With growth, we can do all of that. Without growth, we can't do anything. The men and women in this room understand cause and effect. You understand that every time we pursue out-of-control spending and taxes and regulations, we see stagnation and misery in the land. And on the flip side, every time we pursue tax reform and regulatory reform, we've seen incredible economic growth. That was true in the 1920s, it was true in the 1960s, it was true in the 1980s. Tax reform. We right now spend about $500 billion a year on tax compliance. On lawyers and accountants, all dead weight losses. We say in Texas, that doesn't produce a single truck or tortilla. And I'll tell you the best tax reform. We should adopt a simple flat tax. Repeal every word of Obamacare. expands competition, that empowers patients, that keeps government from getting between you and your doctor, that makes health insurance personal, portable, and affordable. Yeah. The second key to reigniting the promise of America is we need to defend our constitutional rights. Defend the First Amendment, free speech, religious liberty. Yeah. Now, we've seen in recent months religious liberty under assault. The way it's never been seen. Now, we've seen the fights that have played out in Indiana and Arkansas and now here in Georgia. You know, it wasn't too long ago that religious liberty was a topic that brought us all together. That Democrats and Republicans, we might disagree on marginal factors, but when it came to the religious liberty of the First Amendment, we all still stood together. The Federal Religious Freedom Restoration Act passed the United States Senate 2 decades ago, 97-3. It got votes from such famed right-wing nutcases as Ted Kennedy, Chuck Schumer, and Joe Biden. It was signed into law by a Democrat, Bill Clinton. It is that same law that the modern Democratic Party is now attacking when states pass the same protections to protect religious liberty. Unfortunately, the modern Democratic Party has become so radical, so extreme, that they have decided that their commitment to mandatory gay marriage in all 50 states trumps any dedication to defending the religious liberty of Americans under the First Amendment. In Indiana, in Arkansas, we saw a perfect storm of the Democratic Party and big business coming together against religious liberty. But I'll tell you what I thought was sad. Was how many Republicans ran against, including some folks running for president in 2016. Now look, my view is Indiana was a sorry time. It was a time for choosing. A time to decide, as William Barrett Travis said when he drew a line in the sand, which side of the line you stand on. And I'll tell you this, I will always, always, always defend the religious liberty of every American. Let me tell you a story that will lift your spirit. You may remember a few months back in my hometown of Houston, when the city of Houston subpoenaed five pastors, demanded that they hand over their sermons, their sermon notes, any correspondence they might have. Now, you know what? If I had gone to Fox News and suggested the city was going to subpoena pastors, they'd have said, I have a tinfoil hat on my head and thought my helicopter was coming. And yet that's what Houston did. Now, when that happened, I decided I wanted to host a rally, bring together pastors and citizens in defense of religious liberty. So I called my pastor, Heidi and I are members of the First Baptist Church in Houston, our pastor, Greg Mons. So I called Pastor Greg, I said, you saw what happened with the speech. He said, oh yeah, I saw that. I said, Pastor, I'd like to do a rally tomorrow, Thursday, at 11 a.m. of pastors in support of religious liberty. And I'm calling you to see if we can do it at the church. Would you be willing to host it at the church? And my pastor began laughing. And he said, Ted, you know, Scripture tells us that God has ordered our steps long before we're aware. He said, a month ago, God laid it on my heart that we needed to pray for our city. He said, a month ago, I reached out to pastors throughout the city of Houston and invited them to come and pray for the city. He said, Ted, tomorrow, there are 50 pastors coming to my office. At 10 a.m. our city. We spent an hour praying for the city. We then went down to a rally. Had 400 or 500 people gathered, citizens from down to the city. We had pastors across racial lines, ethnic lines, denomination lines. Heck, we even had First Baptist and Second Baptist. And that ain't easy. And we stood up together. We said, Caesar has no jurisdiction over the whole. You subpoena one pastor, you subpoena every pastor. And let me tell you something, the light and heat and attention on the city of Houston became so much that within days, the city bubbled under, withdrew the subpoenas, and surrendered. Yeah. I love the South, but the Second Amendment gets an amen. You know, Vice President Joe Biden. You know the nice thing, David? You don't need a punchline. I promise you it works. The next time you're in the party, just walk up to someone, say, Vice President Joe Biden. Close your mouth. People crack up laughing 100% of the time. But Biden said, if anyone attacks your house, just go outside with a double barrel shotgun and fire both barrels in the air. Now that is very, very good advice. If it so happens you're being attacked by a flock of geese. We need to defend the Fourth and Fifth Amendments, our right to privacy. How many of y'all have your cell phones here? Let me ask you, please leave your cell phone off. I want to make sure President Obama hears every word we say. We need to defend the Tenth Amendment, or as President Obama calls it, the what? The fundamental protection that says the power is not given to the federal government or reserved to the states and to the people. That means there are certain responsibilities the federal government needs to do and do well. We need to protect this nation. We need to stand with the men and women of the military. We need to secure the border. But there are a whole lot of areas the federal government has no business sticking its nose, and chief on that list is education. And we need to repeal every word of Common Core. Education is too important to have it governed by unelected bureaucrats in Washington. It needs to be at the state level, and even better at the local level, where parents have direct control of the curriculum. The third key to reigniting the promise of America is we need to restore America's leadership. For 6 years, we've seen the Obama-Clinton foreign policy of leading from behind. And it doesn't work. Right now, today, our friends and allies do not trust us, and our enemies do not fear us. Instead of a president who refuses to meet with Prime Minister Netanyahu, imagine America standing unapologetically with the nation of Israel. Imagine a commander-in-chief who stands up and says, we will defeat radical Islamic terror. Georgia is likely to play a very important part in the Republican primary for president. And each of you has a responsibility to assess the candidates. And I hope the men and women from Georgia step forward with your responsibility to ensure that the next Republican nominee for president is a strong and true conservative. Because I don't know if you know this, but every candidate kind of says good things out of this conference. I'm pretty sure every single one of the candidates will come up and say, I'm undoubtedly the most conservative guy you've ever seen. Wow! I'm pretty confident y'all are not having any speakers to stand up here and say, I'm an established moderate, I don't really stand for anything. Let me suggest a test that you all should apply. To every candidate who comes in front of you, you should say, rather than tell me, show me. You know, I had an old boss who used to say, if I'm ever accused of being a Christian, I'd like there to be enough evidence to convict me. And the same thing is true of being a Jew. If you say to a puff of Obamacare, great, when have you stood up and fought? If you say to oppose President Obama's illegal and unconstitutional executive amnesty, terrific, when have you stood up and fought? Stop. If you say you oppose the debt ceiling that are bankrupting our kids and grandkids, if you say you oppose out-of-control spending and corporate welfare, if you say you support the First Amendment, free speech, religious liberty, the Second Amendment, the Fourth and Fifth Amendments, the Tenth Amendment, great! When have you stood and fought for them? You say you oppose Common Core, terrific! When have you stood up and fought to stop it? You say you support life and marriage. You say you stand with the nation of Israel. You say you oppose Iran getting nuclear weapons. Great! Show us your record of standing and fighting and leading on the grand. Now, some of y'all might be thinking, I agree with these principles, they're common sense, they make sense, but how do we make it happen? How do we actually win? You know, if you look to Washington is fundamentally broken, I have seen it firsthand. The only answer will come from men and women. Will come from the American people. We need to reassemble the old Reagan coalition. We need to bring together conservatives and libertarians, evangelicals, and young people, and women, and Hispanics, and Reagan Democrats. We need to energize and mobilize. You know, for all of us, not some abstract concept we read about the book. It's real, it's personal in our families, in our lives. For me, it's driven home by my family story and my dad's story and my picture. 58 years ago, my father fled Cuba. He had fought in a revolution. He'd been thrown in prison as a teenager. He'd been tortured. And in 1957, my dad fled Batista. He came to Texas. He was 18 and he couldn't speak English. He had $100 sewn in his underwear. I actually don't advise carrying money in here. And his first job was washing dishes, making 50 cents. He worked 7 days a week. He paid his way through school, and he went on eventually to start a small business. Today, my dad is a pastor traveling the nation. Now, my whole life, my dad has been my hero. But you know what I find most incredible about this story? How commonplace he is. Every one of us here in this room, we've got a story just like this. What ties us together is we are the children of those who risk everything. Whether it's us, or our parents, or our great-great-great-grandparents. And I think the fundamental DNA of what it means to be an American is to value liberty and opportunity above all else. So how do we turn this country around? It's got to be a grassroots movement. The book of Ecclesiastes tells us there's nothing doing. I think where we are today is eerily, uncannily like the late 1970s. I think the similarities between Barack Obama and Jimmy Carter are staggering. Some would just say those very well. Same failed economic policy, same misery, stagnation, malaise, same feckless and naive foreign policy. In fact, the very same countries, Russia and Iran, openly laughing and mocking the President of the United States. I'll tell you, the one person in America thrilled at the job Barack Obama's doing is Jimmy Carter. Now, why does that analogy give me such hope, such optimism? Because we don't have that story yet. The late 70s, a grassroots movement began sweeping this country. Millions of men and women came together and became the Reagan president. And it didn't come from Washington. Washington despised Ronald Reagan. By the way, if you see a candidate who Washington embraces, run and hide. Came from the American people and it swept in like a tsunami and turned this country around. We went from stagnation to booming growth to millions lifting from poverty into prosperity. We went from our hostages languishing in Iran to their being released the day Reagan was sworn in. We went from the Soviet Union and the Cold War to tear down this. Here in Georgia and all across this country, one of the blessings of serving the Senate, I get to travel around and see what's happening, and it is breathtaking. And I'll tell you, 2 months ago, we launched our campaign for president. Heidi and I proceeded to go on a barnstorming tour in the early primary states, Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina. Every event we went to was standing room only. The local press reported the crowd showing up were larger and often double the size of any of the other candidates. Reporters couldn't figure it out. It made no sense to them. You may have noticed when we launched at Liberty University, the mainstream media had an angle. The New York Times said Cruz cannot win because the Washington elite despise it. I kind of thought that was the whole point of the campaign. Heck, I wanted to Xerox that article, send it to all 300 million Americans, say, listen, if you think what's happening in Washington is just fine, you want someone to fiddle around the edges but not change anything, I ain't your guy. But if you think it's fundamentally broken and we need to move power out of Washington and back to the people, then we got something wrong. Cannot win. As they said, the Washington elite controls money. So yeah, there may be some grassroots master as they view it out of the unwashed master. But the money all goes through Washington and K Street where nothing else. It's with somebody else. Well, we launched on March 23rd, 1 week ago in our court. We set a goal. We wanted to raise $1 million. Now, frankly, I thought that was a pretty audacious goal. $1 million a week, I thought, would be a powerful statement. We're going to have the resources to go the distance. I'm sorry to tell you, we failed with that goal. We didn't raise $1 million in a week. We raised $1 million in one day. By the third day, we raised $2 million. And by the end of the week, we had raised over $4.3 million. Now that came from over 51,000 contributions in all 50 states. 95% of those contributions were $100 or less. They were men and women all over this country who went to Ted Cruz.org. You got Ted Cruz.org. Now, to put that in perspective, $4.3 million in the opening week is more than any Republican candidate for president has raised in the opening week in modern history. It's double what Mitt Romney raised his first week. It's more than double what Governor King raised his first week. And the reason is simple. They're fed up with politicians who lie to them, who get elected, say they're conservative, and then don't live up to their promises. Well, I've tried to do it in the Senate for instance. Two things. Tell the truth. Do what I said. It says something about Washington that those are viewed as radical. I just want to close with a word of encouragement. Sometimes things happen together. They really don't. People are waking up all over this country. You know, several months ago I was down in Florida, Sarasota County, Florida. County party there invited me to do it. County chairman was talking to a reporter afterwards. He said, look, Sarasota County, it's a very moderate county. It's a very established county. He said, Sarasota County is no Tea Party option. We invited Cruz. We figured we'd get a couple hundred people. What a good little event. They had over 2,000 RSVPs. Favorite comment of the night is at the event, the county chairman's talking to a reporter. He looks around the room. And he goes, who the heck are these? What happened in 1980 with millions of people who hadn't been going to school, going to work, going to church, raising their kids, living their lives, looked up and said, what on earth is happening in the country we love? That's happening. And this isn't a matter of right or left or Democrat or Republican. This is common sense. It ain't right to bankrupt our kids and grandkids. I am hopeful and filled with optimism because of the men and women in this room. We're building a grassroots army. Every one of you, pull out your cell phone. If you're willing to be part of that grassroots army, I ask you to take your cell phone out of here and text the word Constitution to the number 33733. Let me give you that again. Text the word Constitution to the number 33733. It's going to take people coming together. You know, when I was a kid, my dad used to say to me over and over, when we face oppression in Cuba, I have faith. If we lose our freedom here, where do we go? That's why men and women are gathered here tonight, because we are not prepared to go quiet at the end of the night. We are rising up to pull this country back from the cliff. We are rising up to save.